So we start out by saying, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. Let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. I have a problem, but it's only one problem. I have one problem and only one problem, and that's the continuity problem. There is no other problem. But it's continuity problem is a very severe problem. I don't have a doubt problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a practice problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a decision problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a clarity problem, I have a continuity problem. Everybody has exactly the same problem, the continuity problem. And the remedy for that is the vision of oneness. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So, in our focus here, or our attention, it's towards the vision of oneness. And it's moving our comfort zone. It's not so much a directional towards something. It's a moving our comfort zone so that we can accept the vision of oneness. That's very simple. Now, in struggling with blockages and problems, and it's extremely important to be able to detach from those and get a higher viewpoint and assert what is true. Instead of struggling with confusion, flip the script and assert what is true. This is how it's done. And this is how we evaporate our continuity fear. And when we do that, we don't need these problems, so-called difficulties, confusions, resistances, defenses. We don't need them. That's how they're resolved. We simply say, oh, I don't need that. I know what I am. I don't need a false idea of what I am. I don't need to pursue a false idea. I don't need to try and undo something. There's nothing there. I already know what I am. Reality is not a matter of getting rid of unreality. Truth is not a matter of getting rid of lies. You see, this is very key. So, in your struggles, which we all have, flip the script. Don't stay on the same script that the troubles are telling you. Don't let the troubles dictate to you, saying this is how you must approach this. Flip the script and say, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, the birthless, deathless, breathless, formless, I am oneness, awareness, as God created me. Now, this morning in working through, something came to my attention. It's a big step forward, so we will work on that. It's breathless. I am breathless. I am breathless. I am breathless. And this rests upon the foundation of arising and non-arising, sustaining and non-sustaining are all one and the same. There's no separation between arising or non-arising, sustaining or non-sustaining. There's no separation at all. It's seamless. There's no separation. So we cannot talk about cause. Okay? It's all spontaneous. There's no causal nature of reality. It's all spontaneous. There's no separation between arising or non-arising, sustaining or non-sustaining, subsiding or non-subsiding, you can say. No difference between, no separation between arising and non-arising, subsiding and non-subsiding. That's another way to put it. So the nature of reality is breathless. It's not the cessation of breath. It's inherently breathless. There's no breath to it at all. So I am breathless. I am breathless. I don't exist, and I am breathless. I've never existed, and I've always been breathless. I've never existed, and I've always been breathless. Now, what we're aiming for here is to stagger the mind so that we can get, then let it calm down and realize, oh, that's not so bad. I can move my comfort zone a little closer to this. So without really pushing things and feeling this, you get to the point where you say, wow, I think I'm going a little past my comfort zone. And then, you know, enabling, actually moving closer to truth, as it were, accept more acceptance of it. You feel this trepidation. And then you get used to it, and you look around and you say, yeah, it's not so bad. I feel comfortable here. Not so bad. And then you've advanced towards acceptance, towards evaporating the continuity fear. And all the defenses, they'll all just evaporate. As the continuity fear evaporates, all the defenses just evaporate along with it. Don't try to catalog or label them. Just let it, you know, don't worry about it. Just keep working on what is true. Now, I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit, I am still spirit. I am the birthless and deathless. I'm birthless and deathless. So we do not overcome death. We realize that I am birthless and deathless. I never existed. I've never existed. I don't exist. I've never existed. I am birthless and deathless and breathless. I am breathless. So I don't exist. How can I be born? How can I die? I cannot. It's not possible. How can I breathe? There's no one to breathe. There is no I. How could there be any breath? There's no breath. Arising, non-arising, subsiding and non-subsiding are all one and the same. There's no breath to it at all. There's no cycles at all. There's no birth. There's no death. There's no existence. There is just simply the oneness, the I am oneness, the isness, the I am isness, the I am oneness. So I am breathless. Isn't that great? We don't have to worry about breathing. What is it that causes us such fear? Breathing, of course. Can we get our next breath? Yes. In the back of our mind, there's this feeling that life depends upon breath. We have to get breath. Isn't it great to know life doesn't depend upon breath? I am breathless. Neither with breath nor without breath, but breathless. I am the breathless bliss of isness. I am the breathless bliss of isness. We take the arising and subsiding, we call it life. But the non-arising and the non-subsiding is the same as the arising and the subsiding. It's all one. Now recently, I've been having these reactions in my breathing apparatus, throat, and so maybe it has something to do with this, as this realization is arising, I am breathless. Now, body can keep breathing, that's fine. That doesn't, but the fact is that reality is breathless. There is no breathing or non-breathing. So whether the body breathes or doesn't breathe has no effect on what I am whatsoever. I'm breathless. There's no issue of breathing or non-breathing. Breathing is just like a fuel to keep chemical reactions going. It's like gasoline in a car. But the driver of the car, if the car runs out of gas, does the driver of the car run out of gas? No. So now, certainly defenses will arise. I've been experiencing them all morning. And the way to deal with this is to recenter yourself. Don't struggle with the struggle. Just to go back and say, I'm not a body, I am free. I am spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I don't have a struggle problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem there is. Struggle problem doesn't exist. It has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I am not a body. I am free. I am spirit. I am still spirit as God created me. Earthless and deathless, formless, breathless. I am isness, oneness awareness. I don't know anything. I don't know where. I don't know why. I don't know what. I don't know who. I don't know anything. I do not know. us full stop in the burn of this. Now I found by saying I am breathless, this really knocked out a lot of the defensiveness that it was trying to intimidate me and drag me down. Instead of struggling with it, I just began to assert, I am breathless, and looked at that. Because a lot of what has been trapping me and subtly trapping all of us is the belief that we can go somewhere to get some better air, some better breath, nicer atmosphere, nicer. Now, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I am breathless. I don't need any breath. My spirit doesn't need any breath, good breath or bad breath. No, doesn't breathe at all. Has no breathing whatsoever. See, we're talking about trying to get our body some better breath. But I'm not a body. So there's this whole complex that's been trapping me about getting some better breath, like going to live in Hawaii. And those who live in a place that they think is better atmosphere breath, they market it to everybody else. And what they really do is they get everybody else supporting their living in Hawaii. That's what they do. They get you to work like a slave thinking that's going to get you there. And you end up being the support system for them to live there. See? There's a lot of that going on. So by asserting, no, I'm breathless. My bliss does not depend on any breath whatsoever. Neither the presence of breath nor the absence of breath. It doesn't depend on either. So when you talk about non-dual, this is what we're talking about. My bliss does not depend on the presence of breath nor the absence of breath. It is breath-free. It doesn't require any breath whatsoever. Neither the presence nor the absence of. It's inherent. Fundamental and inherent. It is not sustained by breath. It is not created by breath. It is not caused by breath. It is not sustained by breath at all. Nor is it sustained by the absence of breath. And this is very critical to recognize dualism for what it is, and that that non-dual is beyond words, beyond concepts of presence and absence. It's inherency. In other words, uncaused inherency is just the way that it is. Spirit doesn't breathe at all. There's no breathing mechanism for spirit whatsoever. Arising is not breathing. Non-arising is not breathing. Subsiding is not breathing. Non-subsidence is not breathing. There's no breathing. It's all one. So that means we can have this steady, blissful condition that is untouched by the world. Where we are doesn't matter. What we think we are, where we are, what we're doing, what we're saying, condition of the body, all this stuff has nothing. effect on the bliss of spirit. None. Attributing something to spirit that doesn't exist, it is not a blockage. It's not like we say, okay, well, we have to free spirit from breathing. No, it's never, spirit has never breathed. We don't need to free it from breathing. That's dualism. To free something from is dualism. Non-dual is to recognize the inherency of what is. Cannot be added to, cannot be subtracted from, cannot be changed, cannot be altered, cannot be improved upon at all. So the realization is that the human functioning, body functioning, that has no effect on spirit, has no effect on what we are, what I am, has no effect at all. So we're going slow here because, of course, we're talking about I am the breathless one. I am the breathless oneness. See, all spirit is totally, inherently, without need for breathing at all. Not dependent on breathing in the slightest bit. These considerations have been affecting my breathing. It's like, wow. Because there's a whole, it's like spirit is thinks that it needs to get the body to breathe in a certain way in order for spirit to be spirit or free or something. That is not true. Whether the body breathes or doesn't breathe or how it breathes, whatever. Spirit is breathless. Spirit doesn't have to get the body to be breathless. Spirit already is breathless. Body is just a symbol of the attempt, the belief, the desire to change spirit. That's all. So keep in mind that we're gradually moving our comfort zone. This is why we go quietly, calmly, slowly, like this. We're just getting used to it. This is the key to success. Not intellectual digging. Dialogue, no digging, don't dialogue. No disagreements. Don't disagree, don't dig, don't dialogue. Just full stop in this, in the burn of moving the comfort zone. Ramana Maharshi said, you accomplish a lot more in silence. See, Spirit believes that the breathing of the body that is dependent upon that, that has something to do with Spirit, has nothing to do with Spirit. Just as Spirit believes the birth and the death of the body has something to do with Spirit, has nothing to do with Spirit. Keep in mind, reality, Spirit, is there's no separation at all between arising and non-arising, manifesting and non-manifesting, between subsiding and non-subsiding. All of that is just one spontaneous, one spontaneity. Not separate facets of a process. Keep in mind that everything, all appearances, are also non-appearing as pure potential. And all subsiding also is also all non-subsiding in potential. Reality is just as pure potential. Now, I saw my life situation this morning as a trap, as like an enslavement, and working to get above that enslavement here is to say I am breathless is very important. Because if you think that the quality of breath is what you need for bliss, then you will be entrapped by those who seem to have control over the good air, the good breathing. It gets very tricky. For example, using a great example of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, we'll use her as an example more than teacher. She didn't give many teachings out. It was more of an example. And they said she carried a portable paradise with her. Wherever she went, she trumped the atmosphere of wherever she went. That there was a feeling like bliss, no breathing. In other words, all the nature of wherever she went, however the atmosphere was, however the field of nature was, it seemed to just recede away from where she was. And in this place was this, like a breathless stillness, peaceful, breathless stillness, calm. So a portable paradise, bliss is with you wherever you, the body seems to go. Interesting, several evenings ago I spoke about how the air was the most wonderful air I've ever experienced. It was just incredible. You could bottle it, you know, you could sell it to everybody in the world, but it doesn't feel that way now. So atmosphere is breathing, nature is breathing. Okay, what reality is no breathing at all. There's no issue of breathing or non-breathing, no in-breath, no out-breath, no craving for breath, no absence of breath. It's not an absence of breath. Reality is not an absence of non-reality. Truth is not an absence of lies. See, that's again dualism. to say that truth is based on an absence of lies is dualistic. There's only truth. But it's instructive to listen to this, that again, moving our comfort zone is more important than trying to appear to be smart. We're trying to be effective here. Working on effectiveness. So when we get into this, focusing our attention on breathless, without breath, without breathing, no breathing. Even talking about it sounds dualistic, but that's level confusion. It's like deathless, birthless, deathless, breathless. So dualistically, we'll say, well, how do I get rid of breath then? How do I become breathless? No, breathless means there's never been any breath. You might say always devoid of any issue of breathing. No dynamic of breathing has ever arisen in reality. So it's not a question, how do we get free of breathing? Spirit is not breathing. Spirit is not a breather. It's not that which breathes at all. It's, again, there is no causative nature between, there's no between arising, non-arising, subsiding, non-subsiding. It's all one. That is all one. Now, we may not be able to extrapolate this intellectually right now. That's fine. We're moving our comfort zone. We're not practicing mental extrapolations. Again, what is happening? Simply a comfort zone situation of just try to keep it as just a comfort zone issue as much as possible. That's what I mean, full stop in the comfort zone issue. And don't underestimate the severity of the continuity problem. That's what causes problems for everyone. That's what undoes everyone, is they underestimate it. So they think that, oh, they can just keep breezing along, intellectually discussing, but the wheels start coming off when you do that. You start reaching diminishing returns and you end up losing all your momentum. So it's way better to be quiet for the most part. instance, if you're hiking and you go up to a real high altitude, you're out of breath, so to speak. Is it better to just get used to it, just, or is it, or do we start talking, yelling? No, we just be quiet. We just try to oxygenate the body. But here we're flipping the script, and we're saying we don't have to oxygenate spirit. We don't have to sustain spirit. We don't have to oxygenate spirit. There isn't any elevation for spirit. Practice is a comfort zone practice. That's what it is. I am breathless. I have no nature of breath. Breathless. Now, if you've been practicing moving your comfort zone for a long time, you're able to stick with this and because you're used to it. Whereas if you've just been like the saying, no, give me something real challenging, then I'll practice that. You say, okay, this is real challenging. You won't know how, so you won't know how to practice it. There's no familiarity with the practice. So the tortoise wins the race. The tortoise carries its familiarity with it, its comfort zone, its shell, its comfort zone. It's always pulling along that comfort zone. So when it gets to this I am breathless, it just says, okay, I just keep plodding along. Get used to it. I need to stop for a little while, just stop for a little while. Certainly, when we're reaching these very profound realizations here, there tends to be more quietness around it. It's so profound, there's really not much one can say. Such as, I don't exist. I've never existed. I've never breathed. I've never existed, and I've never breathed. And I never will exist, and I never will breathe. Never existed, and I have never breathed. I never will exist. I never will breathe. I am not breathing now. Speaking of what I am, spirit, of course, I am not breathing. I don't exist. I am not breathing. I've never existed. I've never breathed. I will never exist, and I never will breathe. So this should likely produce some sort of burn in the system, a belief system. It's moving our comfort zone into this territory here, into the territory, free territory. We're moving our comfort zone into no territory, into no breathing. Into no arising or non-arising, subsiding or non-subsidence. So just take your time, take as much time as you want to take. There's no hurry. What's happening is a lot of these troubles are melting away. Defenses are not needed anymore. A lot of defenses are not needed anymore. Spirit says, I have never breathed. I never will breathe. I cannot breathe. I cannot breathe. I'm not a breather. I'm not a breather at all. There is no breath to breathe. There is no residue. So it's like entering a new territory, or entering a freedom from territory, and it's a bit stunning. So you just have to stay with the staggered mind. Just sort of let the mind know you're there. Sit in support, just sort of stand with the staggered mind. We understand the mind is staggered. Don't be angry at the mind. Don't yell at the mind. No. Just be kind, compassionate to the mind. So the mind is staggered by this, of course. Who says the mind is not staggered by realizing that nothing has ever existed is just being too intellectual there. One-upsmanship. Unless they have, are the enlightened one, enlightened teacher. Unless that, but just because you say something doesn't mean that you have moved your comfort zone into it. So this is the discipline of the path, is anybody can spout some stuff, whatever they want to say. Anyone can say, move into the territory that is no territory. Anyone can say, but actually moving your comfort zone, actually doing it, that's the path, that's the real path. Those are the ones who eventually become true teachers. And while you're doing this, you're often meek, humble. That's why it's so important, the virtues of meekness, humility, repentance. I have a severe continuity problem. Therefore, I know I have to move my comfort zone. Therefore, I have to be meek and humble, often quiet, unassuming. Meek, humble, and unassuming. I'm not out there boasting and bragging. Moving the comfort zone, oftentimes you're just quiet and you're shaking and trembling, and it's like, wow, this is very heavy. This insight of I am the breathless one. I am the breathless oneness. I am breathless oneness. I am breathless oneness. That is very heavy. Feels, the inside just, wow, I am breathless oneness. So, of course, staggered by this. So, the ones who are moving their comfort zone are being staggered, as I am now. zone, and many will say, well, I can't move my comfort zone until this. That's nonsense. Because wherever we are right now, okay, with our beliefs, we can move a little bit closer to truth right this instant, which means we can move our comfort zone. No matter where we are, what we're doing, we can move our comfort zone. So we cannot say, well, first we need to do this. Because it's always possible right now to do a little work on moving the comfort zone, even though nothing has changed in the world. We can move our comfort zone as far as what we're entertaining in our beliefs. Absolutely. Don't go to sleep. Just realize the mind is staggered. I am breathless oneness. I am breathless oneness. I am breath-free oneness. I am the without breath oneness. I am the non-breathing oneness. I am the beyond breath oneness. I am the breath-free oneness. Starting to wear off a little, my mind's starting to wander a little bit. So you do reach this point where you feel that it's you settle into it a little bit there. You reach eventually, I feel like I've settled into it a little bit. So always there's that. So when you go into move the comfort zone, don't panic. Think, I'll never feel so. Yeah, you settled. You do settle down. And then you say, that's not so bad. And you say, wow, that's great. It's like going to a dentist, and it's a good dentist, you don't feel anything, and everything's fine. You walk out and say, wow, I thought that'd be terrible. It wasn't bad at all. Yeah. So you reach this first phase, and you get a second win. Like, oh, it's not so bad. And yet it's still going on. It's still going on, so it's still intense. I am breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. How about that? I am is breathless awareness. I am as breathless awareness. I am as breathless awareness. We accept, put our attention on this and accept this and experience it. I am is breathless awareness. We're in the breathless awareness. We are that. Then we're not dependent on the world, are we? We cannot be bribed. We cannot be blackmailed. It's freedom. I am breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. Now we're pushing the envelope here. I am breathless, is breathless awareness, because we're in the end of the age times. Now it's been prophesied that there's going to be a lot of difficulties. Now it's possible that those who did that at the time when they did it, what they viewed was ideological, and they may have transposed it, sublimated it into physical happenings. They say California is going to break off into the ocean or something like that. Well, they may have seen that the culture, the ideological culture, of massive change, so that it no longer seems to be part of, you know, fundamentally as if it under the ocean, so to speak. And there certainly has been a massive change in California, along with the drought, for instance, but that is something physical. But so it may be in a mixture of physical workings out and ideological workings out. But I say that we've been in a massive ideological war on this planet, where an ideology has come from other areas of the cosmos here, just very much like the colonial powers with their ships would sail to remote places, islands, and colonize those places. Remote continents, remote places, send all their ships, their military, and colonize and implement their ideology, their infrastructure, their script. Okay, that's exactly what happened. Captain James Cook into the Hawaiian Islands, for instance. And eventually, the script came in to the islands, and this is how life, society, culture, belief, actions were scripted, re-scripted. So we have an example of history here, how this happens. Now, on a larger scale, in the cosmos, there are cosmic sailors and cosmic ships, actually. Just as the people from these various remote places in the world, quote-unquote remote from the colonial, heart of the colonial empire, when they saw these ships, they didn't even recognize them. They never seen anything like it. They didn't know what they were. And not knowing what they are, it is said that they didn't even see them until they were right upon them. It was like, what? What is this? So it is very, 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 what I'm saying is, in the cosmos, there are cosmic sailors who have learned how to traverse the vastness of space, just as we have learned to traverse the vastness of the ocean. The ocean is very vast. If you're just a little ant on a hill looking out over the ocean, as I was recently looking out of the Pacific Ocean from a height, and it's just like, wow, it is so unfathomably vast, isn't it? It's the vastness. And yet somehow sailors manage to push the envelope and traverse that vastness. It's amazing. And to the people who do not do that, it is astonishing, absolutely astonishing. It's as if they just appeared out of nowhere. They had no concept of traveling of the ocean. It's just they look down, it's just the vastness, and it just disappears. You look out on the horizon of the ocean, it looks like it just sort of disappears into light and haze, and there's nothing there. So these ships suddenly just appear out of nowhere, seemingly. Well, the same thing with the cosmos. Those who traverse the cosmos in cosmic spaceships, not ocean ships, but spaceships, seem to just appear here. You know, it's like, wow, how did this happen? I just appeared here. So anyway, the cosmic space travelers have come to this planet. They've been here on and off throughout the whole history of the planet, actually. But right now, they're here. They have much greater interest in this world. Much greater interest. And so they have brought with them their script. Okay, their script. Just like the colonial powers brought their script to the places they went and said, okay, everybody, here's the new script for you. Take it or leave it. And of course, oftentimes they brought diseases with them that, you know, wiped out the population, most of the population, and so the resistance to the script was wiped out that way. I think in Hispanic areas, massive, what was it, some huge percentage of people perished through illnesses. Same with the Hawaiian Islands, various islands. Yeah. They didn't have any resistance. So anyway, the world has been, there's been a colonial space. Colonialists have come to this planet. They have colonized this planet by meaning they have now introduced their script into this world, and that script is being worked out, and everyone is adapting to that script in one way or the other. And of those of the world who want to somehow get some high position with the cosmic space travelers, cosmic colonialists, I've been agreeing with them, cooperating with them, and pushing this new script on the world, introducing it, pushing it, saying, everybody, here it is, get used to it. And, you know, and so there's been a gradual unfolding of this script here in the world. And so it's already been unfolded, and much of the world is already used to it, actually. So it's an occupied world, actually, with many who have gone along with the new script. So this too may be part of what was foreseen in the past, that this would happen, that we were told that something like this would happen. Is the world would be, you know, given this colonial script to follow, and told that it's progress, of course. Of course, the colonialists here, what do? They told everybody, hey, this is progress. You guys are really backwards. You too can have all this material prosperity if you just let us take all your raw materials. So what do? They take all the raw materials, leave the indigenous people destitute often. Same thing with the cosmic colonialists. They're here to take all of the resources of this planet, and many which we don't understand, including energy, all sorts of psychic energy, and from people of the planet, and leave us destitute, really. So it's very interesting, the parallel about the past and right now, how it's working. So we're under this ideological siege, actually have been, a propaganda siege. It's an ideological battle. Will this have physical counterparts to it? Well, we'll see. Some more, some less. But whether it does or not, it's still an ideological battle. It's like the colonial powers, they wanted to take over the countries without any battles, and they tried to, for sure. Sometimes they succeeded pretty spectacularly. I mean, the Spanish take over the Hispanic areas here, there's hardly any battles at all, really. They just came in, and somehow they convinced the leaders that they're here to, you know, bring peace and prosperity and everything, and the leader said, okay, here, you take over. So the cosmic colonialists come here and say, we're here to bring you peace and prosperity, and the leaders say, okay, great, you take over, just make sure I retain some high position, like that. So much of the leaders of the world are collaborators, and because they want to maintain a high prestigious position for themselves. They feel this is the way to do it. So a great many people are very aggressively trying to collaborate with the cosmic colonialists. And this may have there may be some troubles in the world. Well, I'm not sure whether that this works out physically as well too. But at any rate, as I say, by July of 2016, we want to have moved our comfort zone to such a significant extent that we're ready to flip the script, we're ready to flip the cosmic script, actually. So flipping the script by moving our comfort zone is essential. Otherwise, you will simply be an occupied people, and you will be essentially a slave. And your attention will be so circumscribed that you won't even be able to consider truth at all. You will feel like it, that you just can't do it. That's why it's so important to flip the script now. That's why Jesus brought in A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, the other voice, saying, flip the script, start working right now. There's no time to lose. Can't wait any longer. Get to work. Now, of course, I was somewhat dismayed, saying, well, I'm only 22 years old, and I realized that, hey, I've got to get to work now. no more time to waste. I said, wow, I've been sick since I was 12. I don't really have had any fun. I haven't done anything. I mean, now I have to spend all this time, 36 years working on this. Wow, that's a tough pill to swallow. That's why I avoided it for a month. I said, no. I've got to somehow enjoy life more, before I start on this. But that was not to be. So I had to get started on it. Because there is this sort of a deadline where there's some point, where the colonial powers gain complete control of a place, territory, and the infrastructure and schools and laws and teaching, everything is rolled out and everybody's enrolled. And there's some point where resistance just fizzles, because they can just rain on any sort of liberation. They can rain on that parade. You just can't have a parade anymore. You can't have a parade of liberation anymore. People are just too, they say, well, now, they're just kind of hopeless. No, it can't happen. And they can't even think that way anymore. Once that crystallizes, then the resistance is over. There's no more parades of liberation. So there is a crystallization point that is reached, for sure. Where people just now have gotten used to it, so they're comfortable with it. Once they're comfortable with it, that is over in terms of, making a quick break from it, break out of it. So we have to get comfortable with something else. See what I'm saying here? We have to get comfortable with something else. So we already are comfortable with an alternative. We can't. Because if we don't do this, we will be getting comfortable with this occupation. And once we're comfortable with it, the idea of leaving it is only an intellectual exercise. It doesn't actually happen. So people sit around at coffee shops, and just hanging out and talk about, complain of this, complain about that. But they're impotent as far as actually leaving the situation, getting free of it, because they're comfortable with it already. So what we're saying is, get comfortable with, flip the script and get comfortable with that. I am is breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. Breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. So if we're already comfortable with another situation, then we just say, hey, bye-bye to the occupied territory. We don't have to throw the occupiers out because we're already comfortable somewhere else. So we just go to the somewhere else, as it were. Or it could be just our portable paradise, to say, but we don't need this world. I have a portable paradise with me. This is the new territory. That's also possible. This is why it is such a huge mistake to just wait, because all the while you're getting used to what's going on. You're adjusting and getting comfortable to it. And then when you try to get free of it, you'll say, well, I can't. Oh, what's that? Fear. What is that? Comfort. Continuity fear. You're already comfortable with it. You're too afraid to leave. It's insidious. It's very insidious. So you have to know that the problem is a continuity problem. And the way to do it is evaporate the continuity problems of moving your comfort zone. You have to be aware of that and practicing with this in mind. Otherwise, the insidiousness of the situation will get to you. It's like it's a snake. You never see the snake coming. You don't hear the snake coming. It comes upon you, insidiously. That's why these cosmic colonialists were symbolized by a snake. They're very tricky, also very colorful, and appear to be beautiful, but also sneak up on you very, very insidiously, hiding and camouflaging and moving silently, like they're quietly, and they sneak up on you. And before you know it, you're already used to all their propaganda, and you have a continuity issue now that's trapping you. And then you then just spin your wheels with intellectual isms. Yesterday, I went out to the driving range and tried this new swing. Today, you know, I feel fine. It didn't cause me problems, didn't hurt me. So, you know, I went from thinking, like a death sentence, saying, no, there's no way, you know, that you're finished, to, oh, there is another way to do it. I'm not finished. It's just, quote unquote, very unorthodox. But there is another way that doesn't cause the harm, doesn't cause the pain, doesn't cause the suffering. So I am is breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. See, there is this other way. Breathless awareness. Wow. So, of course this is very heavy stuff. But that's, you know, we're able to carry the load. We're able to carry the load. So I am not a body, I am free. I am still breathless awareness as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still the breathless spirit, the breathless awareness. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit. Breathless awareness as God created me. I am is breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. I am is breathless oneness. I am is breathless pure spaciousness. I am is. I am is. I am is. I am. I am is breathless awareness. I am is awareness. I am is. I am. Silence. So what's really happening is spirit is getting used to this, to realizing it doesn't doesn't need to breathe. In fact, it is not breathing. It's only imagining that it's breathing. And just keep in mind that the great freedom that comes to spirit when it recognizes it is not dependent upon breathing at all. It doesn't need to breathe. It doesn't need to imagine that it's breathing. Holy cow. What a happiness that would be, will be. Sort of imagine that happiness. Wow. Just a tiny glimpse is enough. Spirit realizing is not dependent on breath. Doesn't need to keep imagining that it's breathing. That it's dependent on breath. It can still imagine breathing, body breathing, but it can know, it can be aware it's not dependent on the breath at all. Spirit's not dependent on the breath at all. It can say, well, the body seems to be, I can keep the body making it appear as if it is dependent upon breath. That's not a problem. But I am not dependent on breath in the slightest bit. Beyond this body dependency on breath is no dependency on breath whatsoever. No dependency on cycles. No dependency on seeing differences. Arising and non-arising. Subsiding and non-subsiding. Arising, subsiding, non-arising, non-subsiding. It's all one. It's all one. There's no breath involved at all. It's all one, seamlessly. Now, don't shy away from this effort, because if you do, you will insidiously grow accustomed to the cosmic colonial occupation of this planet. And you will see it as normal and natural and simply the way things are, and a positive, very good positive thing for you. And you will adjust, and that'll be your experiencing. Try to figure out how to be good little colonialists, good little slaves, actually. How to be obedient, good little slaves. So it's worth this effort here. It's worth it. It's not that tough. It's like climbing a mountain, you know. There's effort involved, but it's not prohibitively difficult. And it's worth it. Okay. Very great. I'll end this one now.